Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Youth Matters, a show looking at local, global and national issues affecting the youth today. Now on today's show, we are discussing a topic that doesn't get enough coverage, enough recognition, but does exist and plays a very important part in our day-to-day life. And that is the topic of Shadism. Now Shadism is defined as a person being discriminated on the grounds of their tone of skin colour and being unfairly treated as a result of that. Now, does that happen? Does that exist in our community? Why does it happen? How does it affect a person psychologically, physically, emotionally? And how does it impact our community as a whole? That's what we're discussing today. And we, as always, would love to hear your opinions. Has it happened to you? Has it happened to a family member? Are you aware of this happening in our community? And what do we need to do as a community to move forward and away from the challenges of Shadism? Assalamu alaikum. Asko amra show holo ek topic loya jekhtar kotha beshi mat koto hoy na but oi ekta holo Shadism. Shadism holo manushor loge bad byabohar khora tarar mane chehra tarar rong loya. So ekjonor jodin rong jodin thake shemla nae thora khala akta akta manche ই মানুষ লোকে বাদ ব্যবহার করবা হি সমান দাম জেলা একজন ফসরা মানুষরে দিবা ইলা দোয় না সো একটা ঠিক নেই একটা অয় নেই না না ওটা আপনারা গেছিলেন জানতাম চাই আমরা গেস্টর গেস্টর জানবো সো আপনারা প্লিজ একটু হলে আপনারা শো আমরা ঠেলমো করে হৌকা একটা অয় নেই একটা আপনারা দেখছই নি একটা হইলে আমরা খিতা করা লাগবো জেলা একটারে আমরা মানি ঠাকুর করতাম ফর্ম কমিউনিটি হিসাবে ওকে জাস্ট টু ইন্ট্রোডিউস মাই গেস্ট ফার্স্ট অফ অল ফারহান ওয়েলকাম টু দ্য শো Farhan, you're a college student studying and thank you for coming on the show. Okay. Ayman, you're also a student at college.
Yeah.
Okay. And we look forward to hearing your views on Shadism. And finally, Bradley, you're also a college student.
Yes.
Okay. And we look forward to hearing your views and thank you for coming on the show. Farhan, I'll start with you. Okay. Shadism, it's a term that not a lot of people are familiar with. How would you define Shadism?
I'd say it's a little like racism, but where racism is between races, like two different races, Shadism is more about like discrimination within a community, like where people discriminate against like with their skin colour, like their tone, and like whether someone's darker or lighter.
Mm.
And like, for example, if someone's darker, they might be outcasted by their own community, like sure. their peers.
Okay, and in your opinion, Ayman, what do you think, why do you feel it doesn't get the same kind of headlines, the coverage that it should do?
I think it's because it's within our own, like, their own community, so I don't think it has much of an effect like in today's society. So personally, I think racism is more like...
Because racism gets all the headlines, doesn't it?
Yeah.
In terms of, you know, not in a positive way, but, you know, we don't want to see racism circulate in our community, but it does. But Shadism, you know, when it happens within the community, mm-hmm. people don't want to talk about it. So, Bradley, can you think of examples of where Shadism happens so that our watching audience at home, they can try and relate and see if it's happened to them or if they've experienced it in any way?
An example I can sort of think of is... me being Kenyan,
yeah,
but I was born in Kenya, obviously, but for people who are from such backgrounds that are born in the UK, maybe because of that, I mean, in their community, they may feel less like represented or outcasted because they can't speak a language or they just weren't born in the country. Or if someone in your family, like I have mixed race cousins, but they're obviously still my family. They, in some, not that it happens in my family, but in some communities, they may be like treated with less respect or regard than like fully black children would.
Sure, because of the tone of their colour. Now, obviously, we're discussing Shadism. As always, you can get involved. We've got our telephone number, which should be on the screen. Also, you can contact us via email. And we'd love to hear your views via Facebook. You know, there's so many opinions that takes place on that social media platform. So please, you know, and this show is being broadcasted live on Facebook. So if there are relatives, family members, friends who you'd like to share this show with, you know, please do inform them that this is a show that's live, and we'd love to hear your comments, and we will share any comments, any feedback that you have here live on the show. Farhan, coming back to you, so what other, can you also give me an example of Shadism? Bradley's spoken about it, okay? Can you give me another possible example so people can relate to it at home?
Yeah, so a lot of times it's really casual, so it gets like hidden under the rug, or swept under the rug.
Mm.
So say if you meet, like your family meets someone new,
okay,
the first thing they'll comment on is like how dark they are or how light they are. Like, I know, for example, a lot of the elder generation, when they see something, they'll be like, oh, she or he is so fair. And you don't really think much of it until you really, like, think about it.
Mm.
And you realise, hey, that's not really a good thing to, like, pick up on.
Mm.
Like, you shouldn't really be basing an opinion on someone just because of their, like, tone of skin.
Sure. Okay. So, Farhan's given us an example. Ayman, what about yourself? Can you give us a slightly different example so that once again we can try and explain how broad of an issue this is?
Well, like, me, my family, I'm known as the darkest one in my family, really. So that's kind of different because, like, obviously when I was born, like, family members, they were just like, oh, like, he's a lot darker than, like, the rest of them, like, why? But, like, so I was kind of not, I wouldn't say treated differently to the rest, but kind of, like, looked at differently. So,
And what kind of knock-on effect did that have on your confidence? I know, obviously, family being family members, we love our family members, and I'm sure it wasn't done to kind of try and hurt you, but did it affect you?
Obviously, yeah, like, growing up, I kind of looked at my siblings thinking, like, I don't know, why didn't I get this kind of skin colour? Yeah. Like, it kind of affected me going into school, like, as a family, or even going out, kind of people looking at me thinking, like, oh, maybe he's not part of the family, or just, like, you know, because of my skin colour, sure. Obviously, so... I guess that kind of affected me a bit, but growing up, I kind of more, like, matured and kind of got over it, really. Mm. But, you know, it still did affect me as a child, yeah.
Sure. So, Bradley, how, you know, you're representing, obviously, your family are from Kenya,
yeah.
Okay? How prominent would you say Shadism is amongst the African community? Is it something, so, you know, do you get a lot of people, depending on, you know, commenting, just like Farhan's mentioned, you know, on people's tone of skin colour? Does that happen? So you've got, obviously, light-skinned African people. You've got people who are slightly more darker. Is a big deal made out of people's skin complexion?
I think it is, in terms of young people, when... Because, obviously, when you're at a young age, you sort of make jokes and comments. So, like, people where I'm from typically are darker than, like, West Africans. So comments are made about that, not in a sort of, like, rude or, like, malicious way, but it's just little comments that people make about, oh, like, you're darker than this person.
And how does that, how does that make you feel when you hear that? Do you take it on the chin? Do you take it like it's humour, it's banter, or does it affect you?
It doesn't affect me personally, but I'm sure there are people out there who it can and does affect.
Sure. Okay. Farhan, you know, you're from the Bangladeshi community. How prominent do you think it is within the Bangladeshi community? Does it happen a lot? Is it something that doesn't happen as often? Maybe we're talking about it as though it's a real issue, or is it real issue?
Well, I don't think it's presented as an issue because not a lot of people talk about it, and I feel like it's something that happens with the elder generation a lot, like with, like, our parents or our grandparents and stuff, where...
And it's happening less with the younger generation.
Because I know I've had, like, conversations with, like, my sisters or my cousins about, like, how, oh, our nan or, like, one of our uncles or aunties said this about, like, certain someone and stuff like that. And, yeah, so I feel like it does happen, not a lot, but when it does happen, people don't really... that take a second look and think back about it.
Sure, thank you. Now, You know, this is a very interactive show. We'd love to hear from you. So please, you know, whether you've experienced Shadism or a family member or you've seen it, please, you know, phone us, get in touch. You know, the number's on the screen. We'd love to hear your views. And, you know, is it a problem within our community? And Farhan's mentioned the elder generation seem to be more kind of focused on these the issues related to Shadism. Is that true? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Please get in touch. Apnara goro amra young bhai bonain dekhra amra parents ante dekhra please apnara number ase screen no guraoka apnara ke dabo zoin ekta problem ni amra community maze amra bangladeshi community maze ekta problem ni farhane khoira thain amra sasainte amra mawainte o itar frelo ya comment khoroin manchor skin or khala loya apnara ekta agree khoroin ni na buzoin ekta thik nai thain jeta hoisoin please apnara guraoka amra loke shorikoka. Eamon, so what about, you know, we've spoken about the African community, the kind of Bangladeshi community as well. What about the Pakistani community? Is it quite widespread or is it something that isn't an issue in your opinion?
I'd say like, well, my family is like all Pakistani, so I'd say the variety of people in my family are more lighter skin than me. So I'd say, I wouldn't say it's much of an issue because not many people do talk about it, but.
What about in your community, you know, the Pakistani community?
Pakistani.
Would you say that's something that people comment a lot about? Is it something, would someone, someone's kind of day-to-day life, you know, would it have an effect if they looked, you know, a bit different, if they were a bit darker, say, than the average Pakistani person? Would that work against them?
I wouldn't say it would affect them too much because, you know, like, in Pakistan, like, as I said, a variety of them are lighter skin, but I wouldn't say day-to-day would affect them because obviously they live around each other, they get used to it, and generally, like, I guess you can have, like, affairs here and there, like, within the community, which is why it's not really spoken about too much and why it's not much of a problem, but I'd say maybe getting a job wise, like if you, they see like one person's dark and one person's lighter, maybe they'd be like, you know, like this person's more likely to be like more approachable. Like, so yeah, maybe.
Yeah, that okay, that's quite interesting. Yeah. Now, Bradley, what I want to ask you is what you're, you know, if we talk about, do you feel that skin tone has a link, has a correlation with how we perceive beauty? So if someone was dark, would they be considered less attractive than someone who's more lighter skinned? And, you know, feel free to talk about it from, you know, the African perspective, you know. What do you feel from the African community perspective?
Generally speaking, I think in African communities, if you're lighter, you're seen as more, like, beautiful or...
Why do you think that is?
I'm not sure of the reason, but it's like, this is why it's common for, like, we have young girls, like, bleaching their skin for them to become lighter. And obviously that's a serious issue because someone should be comfortable with the way they look, but they're being forced or, like, they're so sort of uncomfortable in themselves that they're now having to, like, change the way they look.
And risking, obviously, their skin.
Exactly, yeah.
By trying to bleach and try and look lighter. Now, Farhan, what's your view on that? Do you feel that, you know, there's, why is that pressure there for some people to try and look more fair and so that they think that they look more beautiful?
Like, I'm not exactly too sure, but sometimes we obviously see those adverts on, like, TV as well, like, these creams are, like, your skin lighter and stuff, and then in the media, so, like, with TV shows and reality shows or whatever. We see, like,
Have you tried any of those creams?
No.
Okay. Just clarify.
A lot of times what we see is just, like, everyone who's made out as attractive is always light-skinned and stuff. So it's never really put out there saying, oh, you're attractive because you're light, but I feel like it's something in the background and that slowly, like, is engraved into people's minds.
Okay. Eamon, what would you say? What's your view on, and, you know, are young people and are people in general under pressure to look a certain way because of almost the expectations of what's perceived to be attractive?
I'd say nowadays, more so, like, darker skinned people are considered more beautiful than it was, like, in the past.
Yeah.
So, which is good, but I'd say it's still, like, lighter skin is considered more beautiful, which is, I'd say,
Yeah, it's, you know, it's something that obviously we don't, it's difficult to digest because you just think to yourself, you know, we don't choose, you know, how we look or what skin tone
and
we
like
have.
Bradley said, like, bleaching your skin obviously is a big issue, and obviously, like, can say it's considered more beautiful. It's like, obviously, makes more people insecure, so like more people would want to do it.
Sure.
And obviously, like me, like growing up being like darker skin, I'd kind of just be like, think of ways, like, I don't even look up ways thinking, how can I make my skin like lighter, or like, why was I like this, like, generally, like, genetics-wise, but, you know, like, because, obviously, my parents used to be like, especially during summer when I got, like, a tan, like, I'd be like, my mum would be like, well, why is he so dark, or, like, you know, that kind of made me feel bad, but, you know, obviously, I just kind of had to live with it, really.
Sure. And I think it just reinforces what Farhan was saying, maybe amongst the older generation, it's more prominent. Would you agree with that, Bradley, that amongst the younger community, younger generation, people are more accepting of someone's tone, tone colour, you know, the skin colour, or being of a particular tone? Would you agree with that?
I think it definitely is, because I feel like nowadays, it's actually quite, It's like quite cool, like, to be of like a lighter tone, or like mixed raced people, especially, they seem to be very sort of liked and favoured.
And why do you think that is?
Again, I'm not too sure, but, and also in terms of what Fine said about the older generation doing it more, I agree with that, because, like what I said about having mixed race cousins, when it comes to like family gatherings and stuff, like, me being young, I just see them as my cousins, whereas someone older will see them as, oh, they've brought something else into our family, that kind of thing. And so that's then when they may not consciously treat them differently, but you see that small, like, looks they might give them, or
That's really interesting. Farhan, you know, what Bradley's talking about, mixed race, sometimes, you know, that's seen as being more attractive. Do you think there's pressure on? So say, for example, you know, you're still quite young, you're probably not thinking about marriage, but does that put pressure on you to find a partner? Or if your parents present you with a potential partner for marriage, that you'd want them to look a certain way, they'd have to be a certain tone, skin colour, for your family to accept. Do you feel that kind of pressure?
Personally, no, I don't feel like there's any pressure like that, because I don't, like, I personally wouldn't discriminate someone because of, like, their skin tone. But sometimes I do hear stuff like that when people are looking for, like, marriages and stuff.
Sure.
The first thing someone will say is, oh, he or she is, like, really fair, or he or she's a bit too dark.
Not whether they're a good person.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's one of the first criteria. We've just got an email that's come through who does not want their name to be revealed, and they've just said another aspect is, you know, talking about the white supremacy and the history of colonialism, and you can't really separate those two aspects from the topic. So sometimes, maybe, I think what the person obviously who sent the email over is that some people find it hard to move away from the fact that, you know, historical part, historical context of what's happened, and always kind of looking up to people with lighter skin. What do you feel about that, Eamon? Do you feel that's got something to do with that? That we want to almost work towards, you know, looking towards people who might have ruled us in the past. Do you agree with that?
I'd agree with that, because, you know, like, I'd say, like, in the past it was more of a bigger thing, like, obviously, like, a lot of dark-skinned people not, like, neglected, especially, like, with things they wanted to do, it affect their future, like, because, like, lighter skin would always have the higher priority back then, so, yeah, definitely I would agree with that.
Yeah. It's quite interesting. Bradley, what's been your kind of experience of, you know, Shadism, in terms of, do you know anyone who's suffered as a result of it, whether being physical, mental, emotional, as a result of, say, you know, even if it's within your friendship circle, have you seen, you know, are people who are lighter toned in complexion targeted? Are they in any particular way because of their skin tone?
I'd say, fortunately, I haven't actually seen that or experienced it firsthand. So no, I don't think it's as much of an issue with young people, actually.
Mm. No, that's really positive to hear. Yeah. And Farhan, what kind of, imagine, if you're someone who is quite strong-willed, has a strong character, sometimes it's you don't let these things affect you. But if it's someone who lacks confidence, as a they're growing up is tough as it is, how could it affect someone psychologically if they're constantly, if their family members or their friends, if they're constantly saying to them, look, this person's dark, this person's a bit different. How does it affect a person, do you think?
I feel like obviously it'll affect them a lot mentally, and because it's a build up of all these like casual comments. Like, no one's going to see it as something big until, it just breaks them down. Mm. I feel like, especially someone growing up, say, our age, they'll feel like they can't fit in or they can't do certain stuff, like find relationships, find people to, make friends with and stuff, because they're, say, darker. And especially if someone's, not as strong, doesn't have a lot of, willpower and stuff, they won't be able to get over that properly, and it'll be something that carries on with them throughout their whole life.
Sure. Okay, thank you. Now, we've come to the end of the first segment. As always, we'd love to hear your views. We're talking about shadism. We're talking about people being discriminated because of the tone of their skin colour. How much of an effect does that have? Have you seen people being affected by this? It's one of those things where how forthcoming would a person be? Would they speak about it? Sometimes we treat it as banter. What do you think? Please, as always, get in touch, whether be it via the email address that we have or our phone number or on our Facebook page. Afnar Askomra discussion Quran Shadism Luya, Manchur Mani skin colour Luya. Akhtamra community maze hotomanche manchalga badbewar khurin tarazudin for shatahuinna. Afnara kitabuzonikta oini, khine oe, kita razebikta tackle her brother. Please afnaramrare, zanauka, shorikoka, inshallah tahokamra loge, amra break by the baraimu. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Youth Matters. Now, on today's show, we are looking at the topic of shadism. Shadism is where a person is discriminated on the basis of the tone of their skin colour. And we've got experts to discuss this and talk about some of the damaging effects this may have. As always, we would love to hear from you. So if you're sitting at home and you're thinking, actually, this has affected me, or I know someone who this has affected, please get in touch. Whether you're young or old, call us or send us an email, or please, write a message on our Facebook page and we will share that with you from the studio. I'm delighted that we have three new guests joining us on the panel. Nazia, thank you for coming on the show. Nazia, you're a student at university and you're also a campaigner for Shadism.
Yeah.
So thank you. Rabil, you're also a university student and a campaigner for Shadism. Thank you for coming on the show. And finally, Sajib, a school teacher by profession, but also someone who feels passionate about Shadism as well.
Thanks
thank you for coming
me.
On the show. Okay, brilliant. Now, Nazia, I'll start with you. Just for the benefit of our watching audience, please enlighten us about the difference between racism and shadism.
So shadism is an internalized form of racism, which is prevalent in South Asian, Hispanic and African communities. So the idea that if you're lighter skinned, you're considered more attractive and more successful. So it's not just kind of the dichotomy between being black or white. It's a lot more nuanced than that.
Sure. Okay. So thanks for clearing that up. Rabil, why does shadism not receive the same media coverage? Why are we not aware of shadism as much as we are with, say, racism?
I think because with racism, the result of racism is often huge economic discrimination and often violent discrimination as well. With shadism, it often tends to be a kind of cultural internalized behavior that wider society doesn't always see.
Mm.
It's how we treat darker-skinned people in a different way. We might not necessarily discriminate against them in the economics and so forth, but our daily interactions with them, the way we talk about them, the way we see them, is very negative, and that isn't always seen within wider society.
Sure.
They don't see the kind of diversity within our communities.
Okay, and Sajib, what are your kind of personal experiences of shadism?
Well, I think, what the students came on earlier and were talking about, that they may not have necessarily had the sort of direct experience of it themselves, but they've heard sort of stories or other people talk about it. And I think if I, talk from my kind of background, what I've seen, as it was mentioned, it's sort of slightly more subtle and slightly more sort of insidious in its tone, that you're not really being directly saying to someone that you don't like them because of that, but you're sort of treating them slightly differently because of whether, you know, you have some kind of biases towards lighter skin or darker skin or whatever it is. But I think with the experiences of in schools, for example, from my background, what I've seen in school, you do see it a lot with the kids who don't really understand too much about it, but they will tease children based on their skin colour, and you do notice that kind of stuff. And we do treat it quite seriously, as you would do with racism. So,
sure.
But like you mentioned, shadism being slightly different in its meaning, I don't think there's much awareness on that.
Mm. Now, Nazia, you know, you've worked around shadism for a while. What do you say to people who are of the view that it doesn't exist, or it's not something that's important enough to discuss? Because I'm sure, you know, have you come across people who have that view?
Yeah, I think especially with the kind of old generation, I think they're in denial that this issue even exists. I think because it's kind of normalized to say to someone, you're really dark or you're really fair, and to kind of make these kind of comments, especially kind of in social settings like weddings or social gatherings, in the Bengali community in particular, it's okay to describe someone's skin color as moila or fosha, these kind of terms that are associated with dirt, because moila means dirty. So that's something that I really kind of want to put across, that it's wrong to make these kind of terms.
Okay. And Rabi, why does it happen?
So within the South Asian communities, it's been happening. A lot of people say that it's been happening since partly because of the days of colonization.
Sure.
We were taught by the British to love fair skin and to see ourselves as inferior, and that we've kind of internalized that within ourselves and just projected it within amongst our own people. And you do also see it outside our communities. You do see it particularly within Arab communities as well, and how they actually look at us as South Asians. But I'd say that it actually goes beyond colonization. It's been there for a very long time. And like Nazia said, for some reason, we view in our community dark skin as dirt and as lower class. And that's one of the main problems. We've always become socially conditioned to see light skin as just beautiful automatically, and the dark skin is something to be avoided.
Mm. I think also, if you think about the caste system, the Bengal tradition does take a lot of influence from the Hindu system as well. So the Brahmins, who are at the kind of higher caste, they were a lot lighter skinned than those who are at the lower caste, because of course they were working on the fields and so on. So that becomes associated, being dark becomes associated with being poor and underprivileged and uneducated as well. Mm. So I think that's also coupled with colonialism.
Mm. Would you say someone who makes a comment like that, they could have underlining intentions behind why they're saying it? Are they trying to almost put someone down when they make that kind of distinction?
Yeah, I think, yeah, it's definitely a derogatory term to kind of say, to have these kind of values.
Okay. Sajib, how can shadism affect a person? So yeah, say a young person growing up, you work in the education sector.
Yeah, like I say, if a child, I mean, all they want to do is fit in, and they want to be able to, you know, be as part of the group, get involved in things. And if they're being sort of singled out because of that, you know, not only obviously it hurts and it's something that, you know, has to be dealt with, but they're going to grow up thinking that their value is only worth in their skin tone, and their value is only worth in how, the colour of their skin affects whether they're going to be.
Sajid, I'm going to come back to you. We've got a caller on the line. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
So, I'm calling from Tunbridge.
Okay, thank you for calling.
That's okay. Hi, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing? You all right?
I'm good. I'm fascinated by today's topic.
Brilliant.
I didn't know that this sort of thing even existed. It's awful.
So have you experienced it in your life growing up?
No. I'm just intrigued that you actually have this as a topic today. And I cannot believe that a lot of individuals feel the need to change themselves to be accepted. We're far more educated than that, surely.
Yeah, you'd like to think so, but you know, I think based on some of the comments that we heard from our younger
sure, guests, sure. Yeah. I think, you know, there's a lot of insecurities, a lot of confidence issues as well, I suppose. But, you know, for someone to take time out to actually look at themselves and say, ooh, I don't look right, I need to do something about it. I mean, that is a huge, huge issue and a challenge for themselves, because how on earth do you maintain it? You know, once you've changed yourself, how do you continue to change yourself? Mm. It goes beyond repair. You don't have any sort of identity. Mm. You then are someone like a throwback. You're not part of the crowd. Sure. But you're so desperate to be part of the crowd that you decide to change yourself. Mm. But I think in the 21st century, it's fair to say we accept all. We're one people, and we should be developing our inner selves more than anything else. And I think skin color, racism is old news to me. However, I know people interact every day with other people, and, you know, people think, oh, it's, you know, oh, I've just, you know, somebody's racist, somebody's a bully, and I need to do something about it. But if there's absolutely nothing wrong with you whatsoever, there's simply no need.
Yeah, thank you for, you know, those really kind words of advice, and hopefully people who are watching this and might be affected by it, they can take some comfort from that. We've got another caller on the line. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Hello, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. How would you like to contribute, brother?
Yeah, brother, I just want to say a fantastic show. I just want to quickly make a point. I think this all stems from a lot older generation. They have this mentality of, you know, if you're fair, I think your guests have mentioned it, and the previous guest just before the break, their perception is the fairer you are, the more beautiful you are, and you have opportunities, and, you know, in terms of marriage, jobs, and etc. So there's a long list, basically. But I think it's all coming back to during the time where, you know, the war with Pakistan. You know, I think you were seen inferior, and obviously the Punjabis and the Pakistanis are much more fairer, taller, and, you know, they have this mentality that, oh, these Bengalis, they're so much more. In fact, not all of them, but during that time I'm talking about.
Sure.
And that's sort of been in their head, a lot of the older generations, you know, as well as they didn't like it at the time, that was stuck in their head. And obviously, I think one of your guests mentioned during the colonization,
sure,
it sort of started from there, and it sort of seethed through. And it's a disease, and even amongst our, this sort of thing still carries on.
Sure.
I would have to say it's only on the, most of it is from the older generation because of that mentality. Of course, as time has progressed, the younger generation, you know, the second, third, fourth generation, they're more tolerant, though. They understand it's not about the colour of your skin. It's more about the features, you know, how good you are as a person, and, you know, your deen. These are more important. But I think it was more of the older generation that had that perception. Unfortunately, I'm not disrespecting any of the older generation. They've worked really hard, you know, and they've done so much for, you know, for us, which we can enjoy now. But it's just, I've seen it myself, you know. You know, there's so much internal sort of, whether it's direct racism, even from where you are, from Bangladesh. Like, I'll give you an example. You know, I'm from Bangladesh. I'm from Sylhet. But, you know, even when it came to my marriage, I was very open to, you know, people, like, you know, from different skin tone. I did bother, but a lot of my uncles, not, they were quite open-minded, you know, they're a bit educated, you see. But a lot of the uncles, aunties, because I'm their skin.
Sure.
And when they see me, a lot of the people, when they see me first, they think I'm Pakistani. I look Pakistani, you know, I don't look Bengali. And they think, oh, we need to get my fair, a very beautiful, fair wife for him. And I never used to like that. That sort of mentality.
Well, thank you, brother, for sharing your personal experiences with us. I think, two very powerful calls, and I think it's really interesting. You've got the one caller from Tonbridge who's talking about, you know, not being aware of how prevalent this is, whereas you've got someone else who's saying, look, I've experienced this directly. What are your views on those two calls?
In regards to the first one, I'd say that children, especially children, you know, as human beings, we are social by nature. What others do, we like to do as well. We try to fit in. We don't want to be different if we think it's going to mark us in a negative way. And this is especially true with children at young age. They try to fit in as much as possible. So if they're being told, if they're seeing that fair is beautiful, then they're going to feel like that. And, you know, we can say to them, oh, you're beautiful as you are, you know, don't try and change yourself like that. But the society is as it is. They're going to feel naturally feel pressured to conform. And so we shouldn't be telling them necessarily, oh, I think we should be telling them, but we shouldn't just be focusing on them. We should be focusing on the fact that there are chronic problems in our community in how we treat people of a different skin complexion to us,
true,
and how we make others feel. In regard to a second caller, I do completely agree. It happens completely, and it comes up sometimes in casual conversations. People don't realise they're saying it, and they just pass it off as like a general thing. And it's definitely common within older generations. Sure. The one thing that I've noticed particularly is that it's underpinned for me by a degree of misogyny. An Asian man who is darker skinned will have some problems, but I've noticed that it tends to affect women hugely. It's directed almost like exclusively at them at times.
Sure, thank you for that. I'll share an email that, once again, people want to remain anonymous, which is absolutely fine, from someone at SOAS University who's saying, we also need to acknowledge that within the South Asian context, it does not only stem from colonialism, but also the Hindu religious texts, and you'll find references of the evil god being depicted as dark and good god defeats the dark god. So it's really interesting, Sajib, to hear, you know, people's opinion. We're getting so many emails coming through, as with the calls. Going back to the question we were asking, the effect it has, the psychological, physical and verbal effect, what have you seen? You spoke about some of the verbal, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, we have to sometimes deal with like kids using terms like calling kids dark skinned or like using really, really bad terms because of their skin colour. And you know, it's affected students. I mean, I'm not going to obviously name any names, but like give an example of a student who, it was sort of like systemic, like it was through the whole year. You know, she was new, like with like all the other kids coming at year seven, and she found it hard to really fit in, and she'd get comments past my comments because of the color of her skin.
Wow.
She was slightly darker, and no matter how much we do and say, she's not going to ever feel validated by that. She's going to think that, well, yeah, if they're thinking that that's a problem with me, then there's maybe something wrong with me. And that's just an awful thing to think about. Like, a kid would really feel that they're not valued because of that.
And you wonder why the other kids who are saying what they are, you know, why they would make those comments.
Yeah, I mean, you know, another thing comes back to you mentioned about, like, the, you know, Hindu texts and colonialism and so on. If we think about, like, TV and film and media and the way they cast people in that, they always show, like, I'm just trying to think of an example. When I was younger, we used to have Bollywood films on and things like that. And the story is always to be like a hero, a villain, and some like goons, say, let's just say, that come in to fight. And they used to always be depicted and cast as like much darker skinned men. So like you automatically, without really thinking, like this is what I mean by the subtle and insidious way it's coming into our kind of cultures, in that you think that that's bad or that's evil, being dark skinned, and all the heroes are fair skinned and light skinned. And this is what everyone's watching. And they're thinking, oh, well, if that's what beauty is, then maybe that's the way I need to be.
I've got a question here, two points that's made by Aksa Ahmed, who says, to what extent do westernised magazines, apart from Asiana, contribute to shadism? I mean, Vogue covers ones that steer away from Asian rhetoric. Another one is in terms of marriage. We spoke about this. Do you feel that female people... you know, when it comes to finding someone suitable, whether the tone of their skin plays a big part in that decision-making process. Nazia, coming back to you, in terms of, you know, does shadism challenge perceptions of beauty? You know, does it? Are we being told how to perceive beauty by the mass media, by these multi-corporations who obviously manufacturers of cosmetics and stuff like that? Are they telling us what it means to be beautiful?
Yeah, definitely. I think if you look at Asiana magazine, it's one of the biggest Asian women's magazines. And the models that they recruit are a lot of the time white models. And even if they're not white and they're Asian, they don't look Asian at all. So they've got European features like light skin, light hair, light eyes. So that's not a true representation of the Asian community in particular. And this has such a big effect on young girls that are reading these magazines, because like the person mentioned, Vogue magazine doesn't represent Asian people. A lot of the time it's just white individuals. So when they look at Asian magazines and they don't find someone that looks like them, of course the message is that I should be looking like someone that's fair skinned. One way I think that we can combat this issue is by emailing and kind of tweeting and things like that to these organisations and make them accountable for what they're doing, because you always have a voice. And I think if you got a group of friends and family to send out an email saying, why is this the case, then you would definitely get a response, I think.
No, I think that's brilliant advice. Rabih, what would you, how do we counter shadism? What would your advice be? What can we do?
So in addition to what Nazia is saying, we also need to start educating people within our own community that we should not be playing into this kind of discrimination against people. We know it's wrong because we've seen it happen to people around us, but we're still guilty of it. And obviously, if you're not saying anything about it, then you're not helping the people you should be helping.
Sure.
And because we need to remember that we as a community have been victims of racism ourselves from other people for having different skin complexion, and for us to be doing it to our own people and making them feel worthless is double standard. It's extremely hypocritical. So we should be mindful of our own history, what we've gone through, and we should be educating ourselves to not do that same thing to people within our own community.
Sure. Okay. We've got another email from someone who said, I've been to Bangladesh a lot and seen majority of adverts of Lux and Fair and Lovely and the impact it has on young girls. Now, Sajib, just to kind of end, what kind of advice would you give to a young person who's feeling insecure about their skin complexion?
Yeah, I mean, especially the young kids, is that I think they're going to really realise their value and worth in life once they find their passion, what they like. And things like this, the advice I would give is that, you know, if these are the people that are saying things about you, then maybe they're not the people that you need to be hanging around with, you know? Because obviously this is an issue, but it's not as widespread. There are good kids and good people, you know, out there who don't ever think of skin tone and skin colour as an issue. So surround yourself with positive people. Surround yourself with people who could use positive language and who don't use that as a way of, even if it's just as a joke or teasing you, then, you know, by having that kind of positive environment, then I think, you know, they'll be fine.
Okay. Nazia, just the last one before we finish the segment. We're getting some emails where people are saying when a child is born, sometimes relatives come and the first thing they say is, oh, that child is dark. You know, how do you respond to that? And, you know, I've got a sister who's emailed and said, you know, one of my most happiest moments was, I was left in tears when a relative came and said, oh, your child's dark. How do you respond to that? And how do we need to educate people who make comments like that?
I think that just shows how detrimental the effects shadism has on the community, that in casual conversation, a child that's being born, like, that is, you know, a bundle of innocence, is being told they look either cute or not, if they're fair-skinned or not. So we really need to, I think, also understand how powerful our words are and the impact that they have on other people. And we need to stop talking about kind of skin colour in casual conversation and saying, rather than talking about someone's personality, saying, oh, you're fair-skinned, so you're attractive, or you're dark-skinned and you're not.
Mm. Thank you very much. Now, that's the end of the second segment. Please do carry on sending emails, calling us and sharing your views on this very kind of uncovered a topic that doesn't get enough coverage. And I think by talking about it, hopefully, you know, we will be able to tackle it as a community. Apnara zodin asko topico rufre apnara kuchu khoita sain kuchu dekhsoin hun choin apnara agree khorin nana please apnara groka fon na email groka amra khoka apnara kita buzoin amra lga takpa inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Youth Matters. Now, in this third segment, we will carry on with our discussion about shadism. But before we do so, what we will do is look at world news and how our young panel of guests who have come back to join us, you know, what their perspective and what their views are on some of the things that are happening around the world. How does what happens around the world affect the youth living here in the UK? So what we will do, thanks for coming back on the show again. What we will do is we want to present news in a much more fun, engaging way for the young generation. Okay, and what we will do is show you some images which represent some of the headline news that have taken place this week. Okay, and just to kind of add a bit of competition, healthy competition, we're going to show you two images each, and we're going to see who can get those images right. Okay, Okay, and what will happen is, if you don't know the answer, you can have a guess. If it's incorrect, I will pass it on to the next person for a bonus point. If you get it right, you get 2 points. Okay, if you pass and the other person gets it, they get 1 point. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sure you guys are totally up to date with the world news, yeah?
Yeah.
You're regretting now. Why do you not look at this? Okay, so we, you know, once again, this is live, so our guests weren't aware that they would be put in this position. So let's see what happens, okay? Can we have the first image on the screen, please? And Farhan, you will be, and once again, there's 6 images, but I don't know what will come up.
Yeah.
Okay? So, okay. I think we're just having some technical problems, so we'll come back to that, okay? Farhan, tell me about... A news story that's impacted you, or in fact, brilliant. We've got the first image on the screen. So, what do you think? Okay, and it's gone again. So, I think the watching audience, this is a live show, so it is live. This is not, hopefully, it will stay a bit longer. Farhan, so what would you say? Which news story does that image?
I'm thinking it's probably about self-driving cars.
Self-driving cars?
And how it's going to take over, like, certain industries such as lorry driving, truck driving.
Okay, interesting. But it's not the right answer. I know what you're talking about. Yeah. Google, you know, Google and other organization companies looking to have cars that drive themselves, yeah? Driverless cars. For a bonus point, I'll come to you, Eamon. Do you know what? So we've got a picture of a satellite navigation and a lorry. Which news article or story could that be referring to?
Well, I'm not too sure, to be honest.
Okay, for that 1 point. Okay, Bradley, come on. This is an easy one.
I actually think, but isn't it about a lorry driver who caused a death in America somewhere? I don't know if it was America or the UK, but he was driving and he looked down at his phone and then crashed into that.
I'll tell you what, this is, in fact, referring to a story that took place on Monday, if I recall correctly, in Birmingham, where there was a lorry that actually... had an accident and went into a bridge. Yeah. And as a result, and I guess the issue with this was that lorry drivers should have a satellite navigation system that is for lorry drivers so that they know which bridges, you know, how wide and how high they are. So I think this is something really common and obviously it can have devastating effects. Okay, so it's 0 for everyone, yeah. Okay? So Eamon, let's see if you can try and go ahead of the rest. Can we have the second image on the screen, please? So which new story could the second image be referring to? Can we have the second image? Yeah. So you've got the NHS, not that we're promoting the NHS, and you've also got some people undergoing, I think there's surgery that's taking place. So Eamon and Bradley and Farhan, you might have an opportunity to claim the bonus point. Yeah, Eamon, have a go.
The NHS. Could it be that the NHS is like charging for like, or overcharging for surgery now?
That's an interesting one. Okay, not quite, Bradley. To try and steal this point,
is it about plans to privatise it?
Not quite. Okay. Not quite. What kind of stories are going on with the NHS? Yeah, there seems to be so much going on. Farhan, let's see if you can claim the bonus point. This is the first time we've not had a point after the first two. So you guys are very up to date with the news. I can see that. Yeah, go for it, Farhan.
I was going to say, is it budget cuts?
Okay.
NHS.
You're on the right track. Let's see if you can secure it. But I need.
Maybe there's not enough doctors.
Okay, so this one, in fact, I think, Farhan, you were close, but I'm going to be, just to make it more competitive, I won't give you the mark. This was actually referring to, studies showed that about 4,000 surgeries were cancelled last year because of lack of, shortage of doctors being available to actually perform them. So, you know, that's very, you know, and these are high risk, obviously, professionals, and obviously we need people in the right positions to carry out these operations, so they weren't available, so as a result around 4,000 surgeries did not take place, which is very concerning. Okay, Bradley, let's see if you can go ahead of the rest. Okay, so what do the two images show, Bradley? Let's try and break it down. You've got two people who are
homeless.
Yeah, homeless, and it says 2011.
Yes. I'm not too sure.
Okay. Yeah. Do you want to have a guess?
I'm trying to think back.
No. You can pass it on.
Yeah, Farhan, go. Have a guess. And if you're watching this at home, you know, I'd like to know, you know, you can send an email, you can call us up and tell us how many of these you actually got right, okay? So do play along at home. Yeah, Farhan, have a guess.
Would it be the number of homeless people in the UK increasing since 2011?
Yeah. Okay, that's absolutely right. Okay, where studies are showing that the number of homeless people in the UK, you know, and you'd like to think, you know, with so many amazing work that's being done by so many charities and organisations, that you'd like to think there was less people on the streets, but it shows that there's been a big increase compared to 2011. Okay, so brilliant. So you've got the first 2 points. Well done. Can we have the next image, please? So, Fana, this is your chance to actually go 4 clear. 3 clear.
Would this be the report that came out where the NHS employs like a lot of foreign doctors and staff?
Employs?
Or like a lot of like doctors. So I think it's there was a high percentage of doctors are out from like were born outside of the UK.
Not quite. Eamon, for you to steal. And this would get you right up there.
Could it be like the lack of doctors in, is it Europe?
Okay, not quite. Bradley?
Is it that...
And you need this point.
Yeah, I do. Is it that there's not enough doctors from foreign countries, that they're not being accepted to work here?
No, I think you're probably referring to what's happening in America. We're not... It's not quite the same here. This is actually referring... This is about £20 million being put aside to try and bring in GPs and doctors from Europe. OK? So this is a news article that's going, because obviously, as I'm sure you're aware, doctors are being asked to work longer hours. And, you know, obviously, there's been a lot of strike, there's been a lot of protests. So I get the government is looking at the potential of that. OK, coming back to you, Eamon, now, yeah? This is once again... So we've got one person who's got... 1 point, and both of you are on zero. Come on, this is to save and try and secure a win. So you've got a wig, and you've got a wall.
Is that Donald Trump building a wall?
So what is this?
So obviously he's trying to build a wall to kind of separate the two.
Be specific, please, because it's a very crucial time of the show where if you want to steal and get these 2 points, you need to be very specific. What wall are you talking about?
Specific. I'm not sure.
So Donald Trump's just building a wall. People have elected him to come and build a wall.
They're going to go separate two cultures, but I'm not sure.
Bradley, this is an easy one. Come on.
He's trying to build a wall between America and Mexico.
Brilliant, brilliant. Well done, okay? So you know, that's 1 point for you. So now we've got one more image left. If you get this right, you win. All right? And it's a very easy one. So if you get this right, you win. If Farhan gets it right, he ends up winning because you've both got 1 point. Eamon. You might actually. It might come back to you, and you might get the 1 point, and we might have a draw. So you've got. What do the images show?
Is it a record-breaking number of people in prison? I don't know where, but yeah. In prison.
Absolutely brilliant. Okay, figures show that the number of people behind bars, number of people who are suffering from mental health in prisons, you know, it's on a record-breaking high. So, Bradley, you've done absolutely brilliant, and I believe that is the last image. Okay, and Bradley has won the general knowledge that we have of news. And, you know, obviously we've discussed it in a lighter kind of manner, but I think it's very important that our youth at home, you know, if you're watching this, you know, you should be aware of what's happening around the world, because you might think it doesn't affect you. We live in a global society where something that might happen somewhere around the world will have an impact on us here. And, you know, with everything going on, you need to know what's happening in the world that you live in. Farhan, coming back to you, we've seen 6 different stories that have grabbed the headlines. Is there anything that you've read this week or recently which has had an impact on you or you felt passionately about?
So one story would be obviously like Donald Trump and his Muslim ban.
Okay.
So he's just signed an executive order to give priority over giving less priority to Muslims who want to come into the country.
From certain refugees. Countries?
Yeah, from certain countries, yeah.
And how does that make you feel?
It's just... Because we live in, like, the 21st century, you think stuff like this shouldn't be happening, especially from, like, one of the biggest countries in the world. And seeing it's just kind of, like, shocking, I guess.
Okay. Thank you for that. Eamon, anything that you've read recently that's...
Yeah. A story a while ago about the 14-year-old boy, Emmett Till. It was, like, recently discovered that the woman who actually made false accusations about the boy finally admitted that he didn't actually do that, but obviously at the time, because one, like, because of his skin colour as well, he couldn't really justify himself at the time, and plus he's only 14, so, you know, just to know that, like, now she's actually admitted to it, that obviously as a...
Sure. Thank you for that. And Bradley, anything that's kind of... That you felt was quite significant, important, that you read recently?
It's not as recent, but it's about the story of Dylan Roof in America and how, despite him pleading guilty in court, judges are still giving him a chance to, like, change his plea or, like... So it's just how the system is kind of trying to help someone who's done something, like, pretty much outrageous, they're trying to help him then somehow be free.
Sure. Okay, brilliant. We're now going to carry on with our discussion on Shadism. But once again, you know, if you're young, even if you're not young and you're watching this, you know, the news, I can't emphasize the importance of the news and for you to be involved and know what's going on. So coming back to Shadism, we're going to watch a short video about Shadism, and then we'll carry on with the discussion on how it affects us and our community. Can we have the video, please?
Taunting him for the sake of a laugh, when the lighter-skinned of non-European communities come together. But Bengali, too dark to be my wife. Where does this light supremacist ideology come from? When many believe the more European looking one is definitive of beautiful. Marina YC Gori Najibi like it. My granddaughter looks like an English girl, said with a smugness. What scars did colonialism leave? What potent salt was rubbed in the wounds of those affected by the caste system? The perception in villages, travelling in the suitcases of migrant communities, wanting to be more accepted. Bollywood counterproductive, seeing our communities through the lens of the white gaze, deciding who is more or less human. Being on the lighter spectrum of shade of skin is a privilege. In case off their tongue slips racism, hoping the Asian man sitting in the pub in denial of his identity would laugh along because the shade of his skin makes him feel he's superior than his community. Having less melanin than the original people of the land of one's origin does not make him or her more beautiful.
Shadism, the discrimination of someone based on their skin tone. Surprisingly, shadism is said to be the cousin of racism. Rather than discriminating based on the idea that someone who is white has more power over someone who isn't, shadism revolves around the idea that having lighter skin makes you more visibly appealing. The unavoidable...
So, those were two videos that obviously reinforced the discussion that we're having today about shadism and the impact that it has on people and the views that people are affected by and they hold as a result of some of the negative press that exists. Before we go back to our panel guests, an email that's come through where this person's writing something quite close to him, his personal life. He said, this is very typical in my wife's country of Indonesia. So, alhamdulillah, we've got someone who's talking about how shadism affects people around the world. Mashallah, as close as their values are to Islam, there is still very much a value placed in having a lighter skin tone. Most cosmetic companies advertise skin lightening creams, for example, and most fashion companies feature lighter skinned models. And we've spoken about that on a personal level. My wife, whose family are from experience this, and the opposite of the spectrum is lighter skinned Arab. When I lived there, and I experienced quite the opposite. So it's a really interesting email, Farhan, where someone's talking about his wife being from Indonesia and the pressure of Shadism, and him talking about him being from the Arab lands and him also feeling the pressures of that. How do you respond to something like what we've read?
Obviously, we'll say it's not right. I don't think anyone should be like made to feel they're not attractive just because of the colour of their skin and how dark or light they are. And we don't really get that a lot in England. So seeing, and especially in the modern world, it's kind of surprising seeing like how those ideas are still around, like in certain countries.
Sure, thank you. Eamon, how responsible, you know, we spoke about in the first segment, you know, the pressures that a lot of young men, young women, the younger generation are under to look a certain way. How much of that would you blame on these cosmetic companies and these magazines? And we spoke about Vogue magazine and other Asian bridal magazines who depict fair-skinned models.
Yeah, well, like, a lot nowadays is advertised saying, like it said in the video, how Vogue says white is beautiful, so obviously that's a big part to why people, like, darker-skinned people would want to be, like, a lighter tone, because obviously, like, if like, it's advertised a lot on TV, then obviously it's kind of instated in people's minds that, well, like, I've got to be lighter-skinned to be beautiful, like, do this or do that. So, you know, obviously I'd say advertisement has a lot to blame on why it's like this.
Sure, we've also got another email, and we've got, you know, emails flooding in, which is absolutely brilliant, and please keep them coming. We've had another one where it says South Asian magazines, fashion shows, bridal shows are the worst when it comes to actively practicing Shadism. Your female panelists explained it thoroughly, but we also see it in Bollywood, and I think there was reference made to that. We have seen a dark-skinned actress. Have we seen a dark-skinned actress? Or why was an actress immensely talented and stunning, yet was asked to lighten her skin? So I think this is talking about Smita Patel. Not sure who that actress is, but she was under the pressure to look a certain way. We simply refuse to accept this problem and are hardcore consumers of bleaching products. Now, Bradley, for someone to actually get to the level where they're, and clearly from what we're hearing from people around the world, this is actually a global issue. And, you know, this is Youth Matters. We're talking about the younger generation. What would you say to a young person who's actually considering bleaching their skin or investing heavily a lot of money into beauty products, whether it be a male or a female, to try and look lighter? What would you say to them?
Well, first of all, it's quite a shame that it has to get to that stage for anyone. And like one of the statistics on the video is that 77% of women in Nigeria use like bleaching products. Although now we're talking about younger children. So it's just a matter of changing the way they think about the way they look, and letting them know that there's like nothing wrong with the way they look, and it's perfectly acceptable to be as dark or as light as they are. But obviously that's a lot harder given all the advertising that's going on and like the media, what it portrays. Sure. So it's very hard to break that way of thinking.
Sure. Farhan, what would you, you know, once again, Bradley's spoken about there being, you know, people in certain parts of the world with 77% people, certain countries where they're bleaching just to look a certain way. You know, there are young people watching this show who might be thinking in the same way. What would your advice be to them? What would your advice be?
It's okay to have, like, dark skin or light skin, whichever's discriminated against. It shouldn't ever be a problem. And I feel like if you feel like you are attractive, then you will be attractive. You don't really need to think about what other people say. And also, especially nowadays with our youths, we're much more accepting of everyone because it is a modern time. So I think if you surround yourself with people who aren't so back-minded, it shouldn't be as much of a problem.
Thank you. Eamon, would you say enough is being done to tackle the problem with Shadism?
I wouldn't say like it's a big enough problem for it to for something to happen, to for it to be solved, because like you said earlier, it's not as big as racism, so not many people are aware of it happening, so I'd say not much is being done about it. But like you said, like 77% of people in Nigeria, like obviously not many people are doing anything about it because that's a high percentage. So not, I wouldn't say enough's being done, but I think it should be, definitely.
Sure. Yeah. Okay, so Bradley, what kind of things do you think, you know, as a young person, what kind of things, what kind of initiatives do we need to take as a community to try and tackle this problem?
Just a general sense of accepting people for who they are and making them feel as comfortable as possible. So, like, whether that be by, like, meetings with, like, young people, or, like, having people, maybe older people now who've experienced Shadism, who are now learning to value themselves more, like, stuff like that.
That's really good. I'll come back to you. We've got a caller on the line. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Wa alaikum salam.
How would you like to contribute to the show?
Just wanted to say that racism and shadism stems from a lack of understanding about the basis we all have for morality. For me, good morality and mutual respect for others is deen, as it works as a framework and provides us with the morals that need to be followed. Otherwise, we can do whatever pleases us. So, for example, Islam teaches us about racism. Is it all right if I may quickly quote a hadith which addresses this issue?
Go ahead.
So, Jabir ibn Abdullah reported that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, addressed us during the middle of the day at the end of the pilgrimage in the farewell sermon. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, O people, your Lord is one and your father, Adam alayhi salam, is one. There is no virtue of an Arab over a foreigner, nor a foreigner over an Arab, and neither white over black, nor black over white, except by righteousness. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam went on to say, have I not delivered the message? And the Sahaba, they said, of course, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi salam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam said, let the witness inform those who are absent. And this is a Sahih hadith. So I think we need to actually, it's due to the ignorance that there's a lot of racism and shadism going on in the world.
Thank you, brother, for your comments. Farhan, so would you say there's a correlation, there's a link between shadism and racism? Do you think shadism could lead to someone becoming racist? Could it become much bigger if we don't tackle it?
Like in the video, I said shadism is like a cousin to racism. I think that is true because there could come a point where people are being properly discriminated against because of their tone of skin. Like if you're in a country where shadism is a big thing, then say for example, if you're trying to get a job, you might be picked, like someone else who's say fairer skinned, then you might be picked to like take the job instead of you just because of the colour of your skin.
Sure.
So they can like quickly become and turn into racism.
Naiman, you know, the caller recited a beautiful hadith saying of the Prophet, peace be upon him, about, you know, how from a religious perspective, how, you know, we tackle shadism. You know, what's your view on that? How big of a role does religion play?
I'd say it has a big effect because it's trying to say that everyone's equal, really. Everyone's beautiful the way they are. So it's just, you know, religion has a big impact because it's just trying to make everyone feel more equal and, like, just spread the message that, you know, whatever you are, whatever God made you, just accept it and be happy with it.
Okay, we've got another caller on the line, so probably will come back to you. Assalamu alaikum, caller.
Hello.
Assalamu alaikum, caller. How would you like to contribute?
Yeah, hi. Am I speaking live on the show?
Yes, you are.
Oh, hello, yeah. I just want to make a quick comment. You know how, you know, you're talking about obviously how people don't like dark skin and it's more about fair skin. I actually feel like, you know, the tan skin is more popular now. You know, it's all about, you look at a lot of the English people, they want tan skin, you know. sort of medium range. It's not all about, you know, just having fair skin. I think it's the older lot, the older folks that just go after the fair skin. But it's actually tan skin nowadays that people want. You know, I feel like Bengali, they say the Shevla rug. You know, it's like in between. You know, not too dark, not too light, not too fair, but somewhere in between.
Thank you for your call. I think the caller, due to a shortage of time, we haven't been able to listen to the caller's full comments. But I think it's as we come to the end of the show, I'd like to thank my guests for sharing their views and the previous guests that we've had as well. And I think with Shadism, I guess to conclude, what we've from what we've heard is that it is a real issue within our community. And the only way that we're going to tackle it is if we speak about it, if we challenge some of the views that are being represented. And some of the kind of worrying things that have surfaced from these discussions is the fact that we have a lot of young people, a lot of people in our community who feel a need to go out of their way to put their, you know, put their health at risk by trying to bleach their skin, by trying to invest in beauty products. And I guess the overwhelming message is that be pleased with how you look. And the fact of the matter is we as a community need to promote this. We need to make sure we tell one another, regardless of their skin complexion, that it's fine. It's absolutely fine, and we accept people the way they are, regardless of their skin tone. So please, if you're someone who's young or even old who's watching this, please don't be affected by this. And, you know, by all means, seek advice from those older than you. Alhamdulillah, amra show endo izar. Thank you, afnara dekhla. And inshallah, amra join khurban next time. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.